Abba Yahuwah, we bless you today. We thank you for your son, Yahushua. We thank you for your many blessings, which they all flow from you. We just praise you, and we want to show our love for you by keeping your commandments and walking it out so other people can see that this is the right way, and let them come and join. Shem Yahushua, amen. All right, tonight we're going to talk about the present, but before we get started with the present, I hope everybody's enjoying hands up. That is one powerful thing. If you can just get your hands up, because you read through the Bible and all the winners had their what? So if you want to win, get your hands up, even though it's looking bad for you. Yes, sir.
I was just going to share when I spoke to Jason earlier this week. I'm going to tell everybody about that. I asked him if it was okay earlier, and he said, yeah, man. He said, let him know. Said the other day that he and Danielle were at home, and she was upset about something, and he said he didn't really know what it was, but it wasn't, she was just kind of fussing. He said she was in the bedroom, and she was standing in front of the dresser and was looking in the mirror, and he walked in there, and he noticed that she had, her face was all scowled up. He said he shut the light off on her, and she turned, and she said, what are you doing? And he said, you see? He said, y'all scowled up. He said, you done killed the power. He said, you need to get your hands up, woman. And she fell out. She said, he said that he turned the light back on, and she just immediately started laughing. But that's what he told her. He said, you done killed the power. He said, you need to get them hands up.
Mm-hmm. But see the principle? Just that little bit, she went from scowling to laughing. That's how powerful hands up is. Don't ever forget this lesson, hands up. Because that's what he's expecting out of us. No matter how it looks like with these eyes, get your hands up. And this is how the hands up help us to overcome fear, because that's going to be the enemy's number one trick. Besides deception, is to cause us to be in fear. So we need to know some scriptures that helps us overcome fear. Go to Revelations 21 and 8, I think it is.
Revelations 21 and 8, but the fearful and unbelieving and the abominable and murderers and whoremongers and sorcerers and idolaters and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death.
So we got to learn to overcome fear. Not, doesn't mean it's not going to strike us, but we have to overcome it. Remember, I always tell you about, I'm a trucker, and when I hit them 4 and 5 decker bridges, this fear comes up. But I can't stop in the middle of the bridge and tell them I'm scared. I just grab the wheel and keep trucking. And that means I've overcome. And so we have to learn to overcome the things that he's coming at us with. 2 Timothy 1 and 7 is a great scripture to use to help us with fear, because the enemy is trying, he don't care what turns us around, whether it's deception or fear, he doesn't care.
2 Timothy 1 and 7, for Yahweh has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind.
And so in Romans 8, 31, I'm just keep throwing some scriptures out for fear to help us overcome, because it strikes us all. I don't care who you are. It strikes us, but you got to know how to overcome it.
Romans 8 and 31, what shall we then say to these things? If Yahweh be for us, who can be against us?
Psalms 27, 1 through 4 or 5, somewhere around in there.
All right, Psalms 27, beginning in verse 1. Yahweh is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? Yahweh is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked, even my enemies and my foes, came upon me to eat up my flesh, they stumbled and fell. And though an army should encamp against me, my heart will not fear. And though war should rise against me, in this will I be confident. One thing have I desired of Yahweh, that is what I will seek after, that I may dwell in the house of Yahweh all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of Yahweh and to inquire in his temple. For in the time of trouble he shall hide me in his pavilion, and in the secret of his tabernacle he shall hide me. He shall set me up upon a rock.
Isaiah 54:17.
All right, Isaiah 54 and 17. No weapon that is formed against you shall prosper, And every tongue that shall rise against you in judgment, you shall condemn. This is the heritage of the servants of Yahweh, and their righteousness is of me, says Yahweh.
So we have to have scriptures to help us overcome. Remember, we had the lesson, it is written. That's what we need to say, it is written. Yahweh has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. Remember in Matthew chapter 4 and started verse 4, Yahushua always said, it is written, before he quoted his scripture. So he's our example. So you say, it is written. Yahweh is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? Yahweh is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked, even my enemies, and my foes came upon me, eat up my flesh, they stumble and fail. Or it is written, Yahweh has not given us spirit of fear, but power, love, and a sound mind. And, you know, just put, it is written. It's like the tag, as we know it today. It's the tag you want to have. It is written. Then put your scripture in there. Go to Matthew 4, and we'll see how Yahushua did it. Matthew 4 and 4.
Matthew 4 and 4, but he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of Yahweh.
All right, just keep going through him to show him the three times he said it is written. I may have jumped the gun.
Matthew 4 and 7 says, Yahushua said to him, it is written again, you shall not tempt Yahweh your Elohim. And then verse 10 says, then said Yahushua unto him, get thee hence, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship Yahweh your Elohim, and him only shall you serve.
So he used that tag, it is written. Because why would he say it is written? Go to Psalms 119 and, oh boy, I'm going to say 89. Where it says, thy word, O Yahweh, is forever settled in heaven. So when I say it is written, when something is written, when Yahweh writes something, it can't be changed or altered. See, and that's why Yahushua knew when he said it is written, it couldn't be changed. Or so when we say the same thing, it can't be changed or altered. Was I right on? I'm 70 years old. Give me a break. I used to have photographic memory, but it don't work so well nowadays. You want to read for me?
Psalm 119 and 89 says, forever, O Yahweh, your word is settled in heaven.
So if it's settled in heaven, that means it cannot be changed or altered. That's what we need to, that's why these scriptures are so powerful. That's why his word is so powerful. It cannot be changed or altered. It's just like, who was it? Was it Cyrus or Nebuchadnezzar? Whoever made a decree. And in the decree, when the king signed the decree, it couldn't be changed or altered. Well, we serve the king of the universe. So if natural man knows that, when the, it might have been Darius or Cyrus, whoever it was in the book of Daniel, when they signed the decree, those guys were after Daniel and them. And they knew once the decree was signed, it couldn't be changed. The king himself couldn't change it, but once it's signed, it had to stay that way. Well, we serve the king of the universe, so once we say, it is written, and then put your verse there, we might say, and we know that Romans 8:28, we know that all things work together for good, that them that love Yahweh, them are called according to his purpose. But let's go to Hebrews 4 and 12 and 13, and listen to these two scriptures. This is why his word is so powerful. Look where the word can go to. That's why we want to quote it out loud.
Hebrews 4, beginning in verse 12. For the word of Yahweh is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner in the thoughts of the intents of the heart. Neither is there any creature that is not manifest in his sight, but all things are naked and open under the eyes of whom of him with whom we have to do.
You see how powerful his word is? It can get to your soul, your spirit, your flesh, and even your thoughts. See, he knows our thoughts before we think them. That's called the subconscious realm or the unconscious realm is way down there. See, and that's why we want to use his word, because that's how powerful it can get. Look, he created the universe by his spoken, what is that, Psalms? I forget. He said, it spoke and it stood still. He spoke and it was created. Well, we're made in his image and likeness, but not like we were. So now we have to go and use it is written, because sin knocked out a whole lot of things for us. But Yahushua came to restore that. And so he restored it by saying, it is written. How many see that? And this will help us to overcome fear, because he's using fear for us to be afraid of this and be afraid of that. There's one in Psalms, I forget where it's at, 138:1 or something like that. It says, the wicked flee when nobody pursue, but the righteous are what? Bold as a lion. So it's time for us to get bold and not weak. How many see that? Because what's the world getting? No, they're getting bold with what they're doing. Proverbs, all right.
Proverbs 28:1. The wicked flee when no man pursues, but the righteous are bold as a lion.
So that's why we got to get bold. We can't back down, turn around, or any of that. Because our boldness says Yahweh is in control. See, when I say it is written, my enemy should come at me one way, flee before me seven ways, he shall be smitten before my face. That can't be changed or altered. See, but you got to use it. See, you just can't say, get away from me. No, use the scripture, just like Yahushua did. He said, it is written. So we need to put that tag on there. It is written, then quote your scripture. This helps us overcome fear, and because he's after us, and he doesn't care how we fall. He doesn't care, as long as we fall. See, where's that scripture? A just man falleth seven times and gets back up again. Is that Micah or somewhere like that? But in other words, we got to get back up again. Sometimes we do fall. We make a mistake. We fail.
It's Proverbs 24:16. It says, for a just man falls seven times and rises up again, but the wicked shall fall into mischief.
See, so even when we fall, he says, get back up again. Say, get back up again. That's what the righteous do. They know, never give up, just get back up again. How many see this about fear? Because he's after us. I was trying to get to my lesson, but I guess I'll go with this one while we're rolling. What kept Israel at the Red Sea? They did what? They shut the power off. That's what fear does. It shuts the power off so that he can't work for us. Go to Hebrews 11:6. He that cometh to him must believe that he is, and he is rewarded them that diligently seek him. Okay.
All right, Hebrews 11:6. But without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that comes to Yahweh must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him.
See, so we got to seek him by saying his word. See, because his words can't be changed or altered. Just think about it. Is the sun still in the same place after all these billions of years? Do you know what would happen if the sun moved 1 degree the wrong way? We'd either freeze or burn up. One. The stars are still in the same place he put them in. And the only one can take them down is who? Him. That's why global warming and climate change is the biggest farce you ever seen. Biggest fake stuff ever going. A lot of people said last week, oh, this must be global warming. This must be, and we was freezing to death, 19 and on down, 18, whatever your degree was. Some of them had minus degrees. See, so everything he said, did you find that one where he spoke and it stood still? Psalm something, never did I find that. Microphone. Well, say it. Maybe somebody can find it.
It also says in Psalms, I don't have my Bible right here on my lap with me. It says that that he, that we can't, we basically, we can't do anything to destroy this earth. It's his. He controls it.
Yeah, we didn't, here's the thing. We didn't create it, so we can't destroy. If we could destroy, that would make us what? That would make us greater than him. And we know that's not right. Because we have trouble finding out what's all in the DNA. See, it's like Job. He asked Job, who is this that doth encounter by words without knowledge? Or who is this big dummy talking to me? He said, where was you at when I laid the foundations? Where was you at when I gave the seed the decree? See? And all these things he began to ask Job, because man has no power over that. They talk about a harp. They got control of the weather, really. If they did, they would be greater than Yahweh. Because he told the seed, you go this far, no further. See? So he's still in control, always will be in control. Yes, ma'am. Yeah, Psalms 33 and 9. Okay.
All right, Psalm 33 and 9. For he spoke and it was done. He commanded and it stood fast.
So here's what we need to realize. And everybody listen to this. Our words are our vehicles to get things done. Yahweh spake and he commanded and it was. We do the same thing. We tell our, well, we used to tell our children, go here, and they went there. See, it's just like the soldier told Yahushua. He says, I'm a man under authority. I tell him to go here, and he goes, or go there, and he goes. See, so your words are the vehicles by which we get things done. Two things powerful is pink tornado. Hands in the air. See? These two things are powerful. See, he spake, he commanded, and it stood still. And we do the same thing, just on a smaller scale. We speak and things begin to happen, don't they? That's why we've got to be careful what we speak. All this negative stuff, especially toward our children. Don't put those negative things on your children. And you wonder why they're so nuts and crazy. Because you did it. Remember, the prayer of the parents outweighs the prayer of the children. In most cases. So we got to be careful what we pray over our children. Pray good things, even though they're going the wrong way. I tell you about me. I was going the wrong way, and my mama still prayed for me every day. See? I was going totally, kind of going backwards, and I was in a hurry. But she still prayed for me. So even though they're going the wrong way, that's what prayer does. It changes things. So when we speak it, it's the vehicle to go out and start things to change. And then all of a sudden you hear, I remember this. You told me this. And on and on and on. See, that's why these words we speak are so powerful. Hands up, so powerful. See, another thing, when fear strikes you, put your hands up. Here's another scripture I use. This is the day Yahuwah has made. I will rejoice and be glad therein, or sadness or depression, whatever. That's what the scriptures are there for, to help us overcome depression and things like that. Throw your hands up and say, I will rejoice. This is the day, it is written, this is the day Yahuwah has made, I will rejoice and be glad therein. See, we got to learn to help ourselves, because sometimes we're not going to be around each other. Talking about fear, when Goliath was there, what happened to the mighty army of Israel? They took off. But there was a little shepherd boy who had no fear. See, look what he did. And they got jealous of the little shepherd boy. Wasn't his fault. They were the big soldiers. They should have done it. But here comes somebody, little bitty guy, young guy, and he says, watch me. Because he didn't have fear, he took him out. Goliath. And so let us work on that, okay? All right. Last week we worked on the past that could propel you forward or hold you back. Now we're looking at the present. The present can propel you forward or it can hold you back. Now here's the thing we need to realize. Our past is what brought us to the present. Say it again. Our past is what brought us to the present. So what takes us forward from there? The present takes us where? To the future. I mean, it won't be better. So you have to do something with where we're at right now. Let's go to Romans 8. And is it 18 where he says, I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared to the glory that shall be revealed in us. And so what we're doing right today, is that it? Okay.
Yeah, Romans 8 and 18. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us.
So what we're doing with the present says what's happening in our future. Our past brought us to today, but our present will take us into the future and what happens. So that's why we don't want to waste time doing nothing, having idle minds and just sitting around doing that. We need to prepare ourselves in some kind of way for the future. How many see that? This is how we get there. You work on yourself. Let me say something about to the new people that are listening. When you start this journey, we're not trying to make anybody feel bad, but because we understand there's a place of transition. We give you a chance to transition, like using the name. We use the name of Yahweh instead of G-O-D, or we use the name Yahushua instead of the J word. But you got to, it took us a while, so we're giving you a while to transition. But there must be some show of, what's the word I'm looking for? Progress. Must be some progress in that. And so practice makes what? Perfect. See? And so we realize there's a transition period getting away from what we thought was right, like pork and all this unclean food. The holidays and all these things, we realize you have to transition for them. And now the best time to really make a transition is this bit, one of the biggest ones is gone. Now you can set up and tell your family, I'm done with it. No more. See, that's transitioning away. We have to learn to transition from things. None of us got it all at once. So don't look down your nose at somebody else that's transitioning, okay? We realize that. We didn't get it all at once. It took us years to get where we're at today, but we always showed progress in transition. And it didn't take us very long. Once we saw that we could prove the truth to ourselves, it was real, it made it easier. The way doesn't get easy, it gets easier. Remember, it's like weightlifting. You start out with 5 pounds, and pretty soon you say, hey. Then they put 10 pounds, hey. Does the weight get any lighter? Nope. You just get stronger. And so this is how you get stronger. You start practicing where you're at and realize I'm transitioning. So sometimes you may make a mistake and say the J word or the G word or all of that. We realize that. We give you a space to transition, okay? Because it takes it took us all a while to transition away from that because it was drilled in us. It was marred in us. We were marred with it. Yeah, branded with it. So it took a while to get it out of us. But work on it is what I'm saying. And so, because of the present, as Paul said, I reckon that the sufferings of this present, so what we're going through at this present time is not worthy to be compared to where we shall be. But we got to use the present time wisely. Use it wisely. So that what we're doing is going to help us tomorrow. See, because we don't want us, how many want to stay in the same place every day? That's called stunted or stuck in a rut. And we don't want to be that. Sometimes we get stuck in a rut because we refuse to practice. And that's a bad thing. You're going to be practicing for the rest of your life. I still practice. I'm a guitar player. I've been playing guitar since 1975. Guess what I've done today? I got in that practice. That's a long time. But I still have to practice. So we need to learn to practice. And practicing doing something today will help us tomorrow. Because that's what we're trying to move to. Don't be afraid of today if we're doing something. And I'll make it real simple. We all have been there one time or another. We worked all week long because we were looking at the eagle fly on when? Friday. See, that was present because we were looking toward what? Friday when the eagle fly, when I get paid. In case you, some people may not know what the eagle fly is. That's old folks talk. But the eagle fly on Friday. So that's what we, that's how this thing works. We're working on the present in our everyday life to get better. We want to get better. And one of the ways to get better, let's go to, was it Philippians 3, 13 and 14? This thing I haven't, how's it go? Forgetting those things that are behind me, but the verse before that.
All right. So that's Philippians 3 and 12, starting in 12. Not as though I'd already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, that I may apprehend that for which also I am apprehended of the Messiah Yahushua. Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do. Forgetting those things which are behind, and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of Yahweh in the Messiah Yahushua.
So sometimes our past is holding us back in the present. What is that old saying? What do they call it? Doing the same thing and expecting different results? Huh? The definition of insanity is doing the same thing and expecting different results. So if we're holding on to the past is going to give us what? The same results. So we have to walk away from it. Sometimes it's tough. It's hard. But what? Hands up. That's how you get by it. See, that's why you use these hands up, and especially in the tough times, you want them hands up. That's how we get past the tough times. Throw them hands up. This will help us, see? And he will come with the balm of Gilead, and he will begin to heal that spot. And then you know how you know you heal? You don't have them seven up bubbles, we call that. And there's anger bubbling up. And another thing, when you're around that people, person, place, or things, it causes no pain. It's like a scar. You look at a scar, it reminds you of something, but it doesn't hurt anymore. That's how we know we've overcome. The past, letting the past go so I can take care of the present, because it's the, where we're at today says where we're going to be tomorrow. How many see that? See, Isaac, if you didn't work today, you shouldn't expect that tomorrow, should you? See, that's what we're talking about. That's how simple this thing is. And Yahweh wants us to see us. Look at, he told the disciples, he that left family, friends, find this for me. I forget where that. He that have left family, friends, shall receive in the life to come, 100-fold But that's what their word had to do at that present moment. And now what are they going to be doing? In Revelations chapter, I think, 21, they're going to be sitting on 12 thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. But they had to do at that present time, they had to do what they needed to be doing. So now we need to be doing what we need to be doing. So in the future, we'll have good coming toward us. Did you see it?
That's Matthew 19 and 29. And everyone that has forsaken houses or brethren or sisters or father or mother or wife or children or lands for my name's sake shall receive 100-fold and shall inherit everlasting life.
See, what they did at that present time, look what they got in the future. See, so that's why we, yes, ma'am.
And even like in the, even like in the present, sometimes we may have to leave leave family or friends behind to seek Yahuwah if they're so against us, if they're kind of hostile towards us or whatever. Sometimes we have to leave them behind, so it's kind of like the same thing.
Yeah, that's what I said. So that's why the present is so important to us, how we deal with the present. Remember, we had a lesson. It's what you do next. How many remember that lesson? That was a powerful lesson. When things happen, it's what you do next tells you the outcome of your situation. And we've learned to do one thing next. What was it? Get them up. When I put them hands up, it tells Yahweh, he's still in control. He's still my El. I still praise him. I worship him. I give him thanks. Even if I am in a burning fiery furnace like the Hebrew boys, even when I'm in a lion's den, sometimes we feel like that. Feel like we're just being burnt because we think nobody loves us or somebody hated us and put us there. But the Hebrew boys can look back and say, hey, Nebuchadnezzar, it's because of you that the fourth one showed up. See how we use these things? We're so negative sometimes. Instead of looking at the positive side of the negative. How many understand that? So this helps us to deal with the present, because sometimes the present is hard to deal with. As sometimes there's a lot of failures going on. Get them hands up. Even in your failure. Yeah, you got to get the hands up. Because he can take failure and turn it into success. How many see that? Look at me, I was a failure. I was a drug addict. But look at me now. Most people see me now, they wouldn't think, boy, I was crazy when I was young. But now you think, that's a lamb. But don't fool yourself. There is a lion on the inside. Just don't push me. Okay? But that's what the present is going to do for us. It's going to take care of our tomorrow, because that's what we're working at, because we need to get better, because we got a long ways to go to get better, because we got secret frost. Let's go to Psalms, I forget. See what Psalms 20 and 12 says, or 19 and 12. One of them. It says, cleanse thou me from secret faults. Keep back thy servant also from presumptuous sins. All right, okay.
Psalms 19 and 13. Keep back your servant also from presumptuous sin. Let them not have dominion over me. Then shall I be upright, and I shall be innocent from the great transgression.
So what was David praying over, the psalmist praying over? His present. He said, keep back thy servant from presumptuous sins, the things we know we should not be doing. And then we have those secret faults, things we think nobody knows, but Yahweh knows. See, but we have help. If we work on those things, he'll help us to overcome. And so that makes us take care of the present. And we got good things to look to for the future. Remember, the present is like planting seed. You go out into a garden and you plant seed. That's present. But what are you looking for? The crop which is in the future. How many see that? So Yah was trying to tell us, just take care of the present right now. Do what you can do, the best you can do. As the scripture says, whatever you do unto Yah will do it with all your might. See, so let's practice that so that we, yes, ma'am.
I love that scripture.
Oh. So that we can help ourselves get better. And here's the thing about getting better. Why do we want to get better? Mm-hmm. What else? Why do we want to get better? Mm-hmm. Yeah. But we want to get better so we can help somebody else. So you can't help somebody else when you ain't better. If I'm better, I can reach back and help somebody else that's in worse shape than me. That's another reason why we won't get better. Don't try to get this all to yourself. Always remember to help somebody else. That's what he raised us up for. Just think, if nobody helped us, where would we be? Mamas and daddies and all that didn't pray for us, where would we be? See, so always remember, I'm getting to this place so I can help somebody else. I want enough to share. See, share this journey. You don't have to tell them everything. In fact, you do not want to do that. Not only that, they'll vomit most of it back up. Yeah. So once we learn things, we are responsible, but Yahweh gives us, that's what, and then let me go back to it. I said transition period. That's what grace is really about. It's a period to transition back to the truth. Where is that at? Nehemiah 9 and something, where it says, and there's a, he has given us a space called grace. And I'll explain grace to you. Grace is time sensitive. It has a beginning and an end, where his mercy does what? Is forever, but not his grace.
That's Ezra 9 and 8.
All right, Ezra.
And now for a little space, grace has been showed from Yahweh Elohim to leave us a remnant to escape and to give us a nail in his holy place, that our Elohim may lighten our eyes and give us a little reviving in our bondage.
So he gave them a space called grace, or the present. That's what we often hear, we're in a period called grace, but it's not that you can go and keep doing wrong. It's only given to you so we can turn around and start doing right. Because in, I forget where it's at, it's either Revelations 3 or 2 or Revelations 18, where he says, I even gave Jezebel a space to repent. He gave her a grace period that if she would turn around, he would do something for her. I mean, remember Manasseh. He was the worst king in Israel. There was no king worse than him. But guess what? Yahweh got him turned around. He put it on him, got him turned around. Let's go to that. Let me see what that it's. I'm gonna say 1 Kings 21. Let me see. Nope. Somebody find it for me. Manasseh. 2 Kings. Where Manasseh was the worst king, but when Yahweh got through with him, he repented and got his act together. See, he took that present time, that Yahweh, that grace period, or the present, and got his act together. But before that, he was the worst king in Israel. He was worse than all of them before him. So see what Yahweh can do for us if we just use the present, ma'am? No, we're talking about, we've already read that one. Yeah, that may be right. Go there and see. Yeah.
Second Chronicles 33:9. So Manasseh made Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem to err and do worse than the heathen whom Yahweh had destroyed before the children of Israel.
No, that's Nebuchadnezzar. Somebody help me out, find it, because this is a perfect example of how we must use the present to get past where we were at so our future can be better. Read it. Yeah, that's him, and humble Manasseh. That's it.
All right, Second Chronicles 33:23. And humbled not himself before Yahweh, as Manasseh his father had humbled himself, but Amon trespassed more
and
more.
No, that's not it either. This one actually says that he humbled Manasseh and gave him his kingdom back. And so Yahweh is able to take, I don't care how hard you are. Okay. Let me see what we got here. Yeah, that's it. This is it. This is it. Start at verse 21 and verse 4.
All right, 2 Kings 21, beginning in verse 4. And he built altars in the house of Yahweh, which Yahweh said, in Jerusalem will I put my name. And he built altars for all the host of heaven in the two courts of the house of Yahweh. And he made his son to pass through the fire and observe times and used enchantments and dealt with familiar spirits and wizards. He wrought much wickedness in the sight of Yahweh to provoke him to anger. And he set a graven image of the grove that he had made in the house, of which Yahweh said to Dawid and to Solomon his son, in this house in Jerusalem, which I've chosen out of all the tribes of Israel, would I put my name forever. Neither will I make the feet of Israel move any more out of the land which I gave their fathers, only if they will observe to do according to all that I've commanded them and according to all the law that the servant Moses commanded.
All right, let's go back to 2 Chronicles 33. Here it is. I'll start at verse 11. And 11.
Wherefore Yahweh brought upon them the captains of the host of the king of Assyria, which took Manasseh among the thorns and bound him with fetters and carried him to Babylon. And when he was in affliction, he besought Yahweh his Elohim, and he humbled himself greatly before the Elohim of his fathers. And he prayed unto him and was entreated of him, and heard his supplication and brought him again to Jerusalem into his kingdom. Then Manasseh knew that Yahweh was Elohim.
See? He don't care how hard you are. Manasseh was the worst king in Israel. He had groves in his house. He had idols in his house. He had everything in the father's house. But when the father put it on him, he had to humble himself. And that's what we have to do in the present time sometimes, is to humble ourselves. Remember, humility is not a weakness. It's strength under control. Always remember it. Before honor is what? Humility. So, even Yahushua is in Philippians 2:9 or wherever it says, it says, and he humbled himself unto death, even the death of the stake. Don't you know he had to humble himself? Think about Yahushua. Think about him. He had to humble himself. Because he told Peter or something, do you not think I can call me 12 legions of angels? Boy, did he have to humble himself. See, sometimes we're going to have to humble ourselves. Even though we're right, we have to humble ourselves to show that they are wrong. See, before honor is humility. Humility is not a weakness. It's strength under control. Low is the way to high places. So sometimes we have to humble ourselves, even though little Willis doesn't want to. He's like the little boy. Y'all heard the story of the little boy? little boy's mama said, "Son, I want you to sit down." He was, I said, "I'm gonna stand up." And so she said, "Son, I want you to sit down." The little boy finally sat down. He said, "Mama, I'm sitting down, but I'm standing up on the inside." That's where we are sometimes. See, he tells us to sit down, but we're standing up on the inside. So we got to learn to humble ourselves in the present, because some things are not going our way. What are you gonna do? Fight against his will? Remember, they, Hashitan or any of them can't get to us unless he allows it. And he's using it for a reason, to humble us. When did Job get a double portion? After he humbled himself. See? And that's the pattern we see all the way through the scriptures. So let's work on our present right today, right now. Get better, and then when we get better, we have something to share. You can turn around to your brother and say, "Look, see, I can talk to drug addicts because I was one." See, some people try to talk to them and never was a drug addict, but they want to talk to them. Well, how can you really say something? You ain't walked in that in them shoes. But when I walked in those shoes, I can tell them, yeah, I was there. See, I can share my journey, and that will help them in their present condition. How many see that? So the present can propel you forward and make you better. Or if you act crazy, it can hold you back and make you bitter. Which do you want? See, this is the great thing I like about Yahweh. He gave us the power of choice. It's your choice. You choose what you want. You want to get better or you want to get bitter? See, I want to get better. I'm not perfect. If it's, just ask my little sweetie over there. Baby Dolly, is I'm perfect. But see, I'm not afraid of it because I'm working on it. The present me is working on it. See, some people are afraid to say that. I'll tell a story about this one preacher. We were at a Bible study, and the preacher says, "I'm perfect." And I asked him the same question I asked my wife. I said, "How about I ask your wife?" He didn't say another word. See? No, yeah. So, but let's work on our present situations so that we can be better in the future. And once we get better, we can help somebody else when they say, see, here's the thing. Here's one thing that brought us all to this point. Something was not adding up. When I opened this book and I went to the church, it didn't add up. I couldn't make it fit. Remember, I told you, when I first got saved, I read my Bible 3 times a year from front to cover, completely. I did it for 10 years, and I never could make it fit. Now, it kept hitting me. Something is wrong. I couldn't put my hand on it because they were my elders and pastors, and I thought, well, they know more than me. But I kept studying and studying, and I knew something was wrong. This don't fit. Christmas don't fit. If you don't believe me, just read Jeremiah 10, 2, and 3, or type in the word Saturnalia, and you see they was doing it long before he was born. See, same way with Easter. They were doing it long before he went to the stake. Sunrise service included. Yeah, so that's why we have to work on these things and transition away from them, because we know they're no good. They're false. See, and the thing is, they don't lead us to him. I'm gonna ask you a question. What's the most depressing day of the year? December the 25th. More people take their lives or depressed on December the 25th. That should tell you something. Amen. So just read the scripture, Jeremiah 10 and 2, and says, "Be not like the heathen who go out there and cut down a tree." I keep telling everybody, it's all about a tree. It's all about a tree. Huh? Yeah. Yeah, it's all about a tree. It started in the garden. He said there's two special trees. One is going to bring forth what? Death. The other is going to bring forth life. What did man choose? Death. Here comes the Prince of Life. And they stuck him on a tree. Who did they choose? Death, a murderer. All about a tree. And then we read in the book of Revelations, and I saw on either side of the river was the tree of life. So it's all about a tree. What tree are you eating from? Are you eating from the tree of life, or are you eating from the tree of death? It's all about a tree. Just look at the scriptures. It's all about this tree. Scripture says a man goes out in the forest and cuts down a tree. With part he warmed himself, with part he cooks himself, and with part he bows down and worships this tree. Okay, Tamara? So, it's all about a tree. So, let's be mindful of that. These, and even there are people that go hug trees. Well, I do give you credit, you know it's about a tree, but that's the wrong tree. And some people say those trees will heal, the leaves will heal, but that's the wrong tree. The tree that heals is a tree of life. Let's go to Revelations 22 and just start at verse 1.
Revelations 22, beginning in verse 1. And he showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding out of the throne of Yahweh and of the Lamb. And in the midst of the tree, or the street of it, and on either side of the river was the tree of life, which bore 12 manners of fruit, and yielded her fruit every month. And the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nation.
See, it, man, see, let's go to, I think it's John 1 and 10. Where he say he lighteth every man that cometh into the world? 9? Okay.
It's John 1 and 9. He was that true light which lights every man that comes into the world.
So, check this out. All the world knows they need to worship something or somebody. Because I don't care what country, what nation, you can go to the deepest, darkest tribe, they got their deity. Because it's in them that they're supposed to be worshiping. But they're just worshiping, most of them, or they're worshiping the wrong one. See, because he put that spark of light in us for us to know, hey, the one you're supposed to worship is heaven, but they got off track and been led this way and that away. How many see that? See, so he put it in us. And that's why you see people, they're trying to get to him. It's just like us hippies. We was actually trying to get to him. That's what they told us. We would be enlightened and we'd be like him, and boy, was that a big lie. Our generation was, wow. Yeah.
It had something to do with all the drugs.
Yeah. That was the vehicle. But we were still searching. See? Men today are searching because they know there's something in me tells me that I need to be worshiping Elohim, and not these false deities. The ones that's made with, they take a piece of wood and they deck it with silver and gold and all of this, but it can't hear, it can't see, it can't save nobody, it can't eat, it can't even talk. See, so let's be careful of that and get to the right tree. Go to verse 22:14, Revelations.
All right, 22 and 14, blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city.
Wow. See, it's all about a tree. So what should we be doing in the present? John 14, 15 says, if you love me, keep my, that's what we should be presently doing, keeping his commandments. So in Revelations chapter 24, he said, he that keeps his commandments has the right to enter into the city and eat from the tree of life. Present. Let's presently keep his commandments. And his commandments are not grievous or burdensome or cramp your style. Actually, his commandments raises us above all these other nations. That's why he wants us to keep them, because they automatically raise us up just like that. Go to Deuteronomy 4 and start verse 4 through 6, I think. You say, what nation is so great as this nation?
Deuteronomy 4, beginning in verse 4. But you that did cleave unto Yahweh your Elohim are alive, every one of you this day. Behold, I've taught you statutes and judgments, even as Yahweh my Elohim commanded me that you should do so in the land whether you go to possess it. Keep therefore and do them, for this is your wisdom and your understanding in the sight of the nations, which shall hear all these statutes and say, surely this great nation is a wise and understanding people. For what nation is there so great, who has Elohim so near unto them, as Yahweh our Elohim is in all things that we call upon him for? And what nation is there so great, and has statutes and judgments so righteous as all this law, which I set before you this day?
See, and then in another scripture, I think it's Deuteronomy 28 and 13 or something like that, it says, if we obey the commandments of Yahuwah our Elohim, all these blessings should come up on thee. And three of them was to make you the head and not the tail, above and not beneath, the lender and not the borrower. Why? This is what keeping us, it raises us up from our earthly plane to our spiritual plane. That's why he wants us to keep it. It's not cramping our style, it's making our style better. And that's what we want. Presently to get better, working every day to get better. Some days we get an F and some days we get an A, but never give up. How many see that? And so this is going to be my little lesson tonight on the present, because now we got to really work and get better at keeping his commandments. And once we get better, don't forget to share. And when I mean share, don't go out and knock on everybody's door. We learn, don't do that. Let's go to 1 Peter 3:15. You know how I am.
1 Peter 3:15. But set apart Yahweh Elohim in your hearts, and be ready always to give an answer to every man that asks you a reason of the hope that is in you with meekness and fear.
And to give you a second witness of this, Matthew 7:7, I think he says, ask and it shall be given. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. So when they ask and are seeking and are knocking, that's when you begin to share. See, because the scripture says, don't cast your pearls before swine, or give that which is holy unto dogs. So that's what a lot of people do, and they learn something, they just go, that's not what you're supposed to do. Oh, I thought you had to. So when they ask, they share. Shane's been getting more questions here lately.
I'll be honest with you. Ever since, you know, since Jason and Danielle came, mm-hmm. he went back to work like the next day, and he told them boys straight up, he said, y'all ain't got a clue what you're talking about. He said, y'all have no idea. And they were all like, what are you talking about? And he was like, I went there. He said, I'll tell you exactly what they believe in. You know, but he told him, he said, every one of y'all need to shut your mouth, because you ain't got a clue what you're talking about.
They ain't got a clue.
And I'm going to tell you, I've been getting every day almost, I've been getting questions from people, and had a guy that I've never spoken to about the word today. Worked with him for a long time. He come and started asking me about holidays and stuff, and asked me about Easter and all. And I told him, I said, man, that's not something that you need to be doing. And I just kind of briefly explained it to him. And he said, well, what should we be doing? And I told him, I said, you need to be celebrating Passover. I said, you know, and I explained to him what that was all about. And he was like, that makes a whole lot more sense than that other one does.
Yeah. See, because I tell you, that's what got me started. I just couldn't make it add up. I knew there was something wrong. What they were teaching me and what was in this book, it just didn't match up. I knew it. I said, something's wrong. I can't make Easter match up. I can't make Christmas match up.
And speaking of that, that's what I used when I told him. I said, look, I said, here's what you first thing you need to ask yourself. I said, when did he rise from the dead? He said, well, church always said, they always told us it was Sunday morning. He said, is that not right? I said, no, that's correct. Said, the Bible says that he rose on the first day of the week. Mm-hmm. I said, but listen, the first day of the week. I said, so that lets you know that the day that you're celebrating as the seventh day is not the seventh day, it's the first day of the week. Mm-hmm. I said, second of all, how could he have died on a Friday afternoon and rose again on Sunday morning if the Bible said that he was in the belly of the earth 3 days and three nights? And that kind of was a springboard, and we jumped off it, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And that's where I got to telling him, you know, hey man, you know, you gotta read the word, you gotta study to understand this stuff.
Yeah.
I said, that's what the Bible tells us.
And that's very good. And see, that's what I'm talking about. Live your life in the present that if somebody would want to question, what's them strings you got? Oh boy. See? Why you wear a head covering on? Why, how come you got a beard? Or how come you don't eat pork? Or you know, live your life so they'll ask that question. And then, boy, when they do, let the floodgates open. Don't give them too much, though. Don't give them too much, though. Abba, we love and appreciate you. Son, Yahushua, B'Shem, Yahushua, Amen.